Hey guys, Addict PC Guy here with the differences between an overclocked and non-overclocked version of the same graphics card. Now, I have given you not so long ago in detail review of the 1660 Ti from Nvidia. I've just gotten it, I ran some tests with it, comparing it with my old GTX 960, both in productivity workloads as well as some synthetic benchmarks and gaming naturally. Obviously, the 1660 Ti won by a landslide. It's a much newer card and it's a Ti version, so that's not really a surprise. But the point of that video was to show you how much of an improvement you would get by upgrading from a two generations ago card to a recent card now in modern titles. The results spoke for themselves, and I have also launched a video about overclocking your card with OC Scanner. Now, this makes overclocking your card a lot easier, and this point of this video is to show you exactly how much performance gains you can expect from overclocking your card with OC Scanner. For starters, the card that we used. Now, this video will be focusing on the MSI GeForce GTX 1660 Ti Ventus XS 6G OC. It's a mouthful, that much is sure. It is one of the entry level. It's not the very cheapest, but it's one of the cheaper versions of 660i at 295 euros. That is, it's a good value for the money, in my opinion. It's definitely worth it. It is an Nvidia card with maximum turbo clock, 183 gigahertz. Keep in mind, this is factory overclocked already. There's already some overclock going on in this card, so I cannot push the overclock much further. That is because there is a power limit in this card. It is set in the BIOS. It differs from brand to brand. MSI is one of the least, let's say, generous power limits. It's a very strict power limit, which means that that's going to limit your overclock a lot. That said, you can overclock a little bit beyond what the factory overclock is. So I'll let you guys see that. It's probably not the maximum that I could push my overclock, but it's a safe overclock. It's stable. You could possibly push it a little bit further, but not even that much further, to be quite honest. So it's just going to be an example of how much you can gain by overclocking your card. As far as memory, it has 6 GB of GDDR6 at 12 gigahertz of frequency. Keep in mind that when you check it on it's dual channel memory naturally, so when you check it on for example my MSI Afterburner, which we'll be using to overclock, it's going to say it's 6, but you have to double that because it's DDR dual channel, obviously. As for interface, it's kind of not the point of the video, but you have 3 display ports and 1 HDMI. And yeah, I mean, measurements, I don't think there's a point in going for all this information other than, for example, that it is 120 watt TDP on the card. As for the software we'll be using, we'll be using MSI Afterburner naturally. These are the settings that I am using. They have been achieved. The core clock has been achieved with OC Scanner, which check my previous video to see how it works. It is, I believe, 83 or 90-ish megahertz. Keep in mind, it's not just a simple 90 megahertz overclock. It's over 90 megahertz overclock above what it is already factory overclocked. So it's quite reasonable, as you will see in the benchmarks. It will boost the clock to the 2015-2030 range of frequencies on the core clock, that is. So that's pretty reasonable for a card of this sort, and it's not even being water cooled. Honestly, what is the point of water cooling? You will see it won't even get past the 60 something degrees, so yeah, there's not much of a point. The power limit really limits what you can do. So as you can see, it does not go above 100%, so that is about what you can get with this card. Core voltage, as you see, slid up to the max, although again it is very limited power wise. Temperature limit does not matter because it will never even get close to that, even on the harshest of benchmarks. Core clock, like I said, 90-ish core clock boost. It kind of would be handy if it showed here, to be quite honest, instead of just curve, but yeah, you know. Yeah, memory clock, I had to overclock the memory manually. The baseline is 6000, as you can see there. Well, you cannot see it because it's not, yeah, but yeah, it goes all the way to 7.1 because that's a 6000 plus the 1100 I have here. that is manually overclocked. Again, I could possibly push it a little bit further, but it just won't go for, you know, the voltage won't allow for much more. Fan speed, the minimum setting is 47%, which is kind of annoying. The car does not get that hot. I would love to be able to put the fan a little bit lower. It won't let me. Any case, fan speeds are not an issue. The car does not get super hot. These are the settings that I used. For the methodology, I have simply looked for a spot in game that is easy to reproduce, that has the same conditions. That's basically how I do my benchmarks. Either it might, there might be people that are like, no, you should do a full gaming session and you know, then compare the averages and all that sort of stuff. Yeah, that's all nice, but not only that takes a lot more time, which I'll be honest, I have to rush a bit with my testing because of the time I have available to do this. But not only that would take more time, but there are a lot of variables that are difficult to account and to reproduce. For example, some of the games I'm testing, forgive me for looking at my list, some of them are multiplayer games, some of them are Battle Royale games, some are Heroes of the Storm, Diablo, WoW. Then there's others like Wolfenstein, Witcher 3, which... it's, there's so much going on, it's difficult to reproduce accurately. So I pick a spot, I pick a scene, I try to have like a big view distance for games that, you know, have a big draw distance that actually influences the FPS as well. And I try to find a good spot. I reset my overclocking settings with MSI Afterburner overlay. I check how it's running. I, you know, fight a little bit if it's a fighting game, fire a few shots, kill a few enemies, that sort of thing. And then we see how it goes. After that, I turn the overclock up with the safe profile that I have on Afterburner, reset the counter, and do it all again and see what the difference is. I will give you now a small breakdown of the overclock. Some of them you can notice a big difference, others you can't, which I will go item per item right about now. Starting with our benchmark scores, on Cinebench we saw absolutely no difference. It stays with a score of 177, meaning that there is not much of a performance improvement to be gained on this benchmark by overclocking your car for such a small amount. It is a different story on most of the other benchmarks, with 3DMark, both Firestrike and TimeSpy having quite an increase, and in Firestrike's case a 6% increase, and on TimeSpy a 10.5% increase between the overclocked and non-overclocked version of the same card. The same holds true for the other benchmarks. As you can see, there are quite a few increases. It's around the order of the between the 5 and the 6% on several variations of Aztec Ruins, as well as between 4 and 5% increased variations on Unigen Superposition, both on medium and high settings. The temperatures are not really a concern, with the temperature rising only from 60 degrees to about 62 degrees on a Firmark run at about 5 to 6 minutes of runtime. So it is not really an issue with such a small scale overclock that doesn't really draw much more power, to be quite honest. And because none of us overclock for the pure purpose of just running benchmarks, let's have some actual gameplay performance with the overclocked card. As you can see, Blizzard games, which are some of the games I play the most, don't benefit a whole lot. Because these games are games that are not really very demanding on the GPU to begin with. They're mostly bound by other things like either CPU or the fact that it's a multiplayer game with all the problems that that entails in terms of actually taking advantage of your graphics card's full potential. In any case, as you can see in Diablo, our score has increased by 5%. And 17% on the average and 1% lows. Well, it's not crazy, the 5% on the average FPS. The 17% increase on the 1% lows is quite useful to avoid the perception of frame rate discrepancy that you get when your game is like stuttering. That means that there is a sudden low FPS period, and the fact that low FPS won't be as low will make for a more fluid gaming experience. In World of Warcraft, we saw basically no difference with the average FPS staying at 87 and just one FPS increase from 79 to 80 with the max settings. This is hovering above a city with a very large view distance and everything on max. So as you can see, WoW does not necessarily benefit a lot from having very good graphics card. I doubt you would get a very big increase even if you had an order of magnitude better, like say RTX line card. I don't think you would get a massive amount of FPS more on World of Warcraft. As far as Heroes of the Storm goes, we also did not see a massive increase with the just a 10 FPS increase on the average and a 4 FPS increase on the lows. So again, it's not really utilizing your GPU on the crazy, level. Now, starting with the games that actually do use your graphics card a bit more, Dying Light on best quality settings. Again, we saw an increase from 154.61 to 181.75. So that's an 18% increase on the average FPS, as well as a 23% increase on the lows. So again, this will allow you to play probably at higher refresh rates. It is somewhat worrying that the lows are this low. They are more than half of the average FPS, which is not ideal. It can lead to a perception, like I said, of the game being stuttering a little bit. However, that might be from my end. I might have some program running on the background. I don't have a dedicated test bench, like I said, so there is also a small possibility of error on that regard. Anyway, it is an 18% increase in average FPS and a 23% increase in lows. So the value for overclocking for a game like this is definitely undeniable. It is quite a massive increase. Other games that I have tested that are a bit more, let's call it, graphically demanding are, for example, Wolfenstein 2. On Wolfenstein 2, we saw an increase from 123 to 134 on the 1% low, so a 9% increase. We saw no improvement at all on the average FPS that stays at 211. That really leads me to believe that there is a cap, that something is capping this FPS here. After a little bit of research, turns out that MSI Afterburner might be the culprit, although I cannot really test this without MSI Afterburner to log the FPS. So unfortunately, I cannot really give you a full-on review of Wolfenstein 2 with these settings because, well, I am capped. No matter how much I overclock, it's always going to give me 211, and there's no way I can report the value to you without Afterburner. So sorry about that. In any case, we see a 9% increase on the lows, which puts us at 134, which is pretty much ideal for if you are playing on a 144 Hz monitor. So you are almost there. Just lower your shadows a little bit or your anti-aliasing, and you're good to go. On Witcher 2, we see an increase of 6 to 7% in FPS, both on the averages and on the lows, giving us about 5 FPS on both of the settings. So it's not crazy, but again, we're talking about free performance here. Doom 2016, also on Ultra, we see an improvement of 9 FPS. And well, 9 FPS on both the lows and average, that equates to about a 5 to 6% increase. It's not game breaking. Again, it's free performance. On Apex Legends, as last test we're going to be running, we see no increase at all on the average and a 3% increase on the lows. So again, not game breaking. And it should be said that this game is also capped. This time, not software's fault, but it's the game itself's fault. Where apparently they were trying to implement a 300 FPS cap so that no one can go over it, and by mistake they implemented a 144 cap. This is expected to be fixed. In the meantime, there is absolutely nothing I can do to go around that and show you more accurate values. So that's it. You get a 3% increase on the lows, and I cannot report how much better it is on the highs. For some of these numbers, you do see quite an advantage to overclocking. When the value on FPS gains is 18%, 20%, 17%, and such, you're like, oh wow, that's quite a big increase. However, keep in mind that this usually happens in games that have lower FPS to begin with, and so a 20% increase might equate to actually like a 10 FPS or something. On the other hand, small percentage increases on other games that are already at 200, not only are they pointless, but they also boost the values by a lot more, because 5% of 200, that's 20 right there. So you have to keep that in mind, and you have to keep in mind also that some games are a lot more graphically demanding than others, and other games, even if you do gain a lot, what's the point? Imagine you're playing a strategy game, getting an extra 30 FPS has absolutely no interest. Well, if you're playing a fast-paced shooter, you do have a tangible benefit to high FPS. In any case, other results are not super impressive. 5% gains, 4% gains, that don't even help you reach a threshold of refresh rate or something. You might think, yeah, well, what's the point? And the point is not necessarily the FPS that you gain in the situation right now. The point is that it is free performance gains at zero risk. It does not cost you anything else. It doesn't even cost you more electricity because you can see the card is power limited. It's not going to be drawing more power, even if you wanted to, it can't. And yeah, it's just a matter of optimizing the settings and pushing the card like literally to its limits. Sure, you have to optimize a little bit, but it's free performance, and you're getting free performance out of your product that you already paid for. So it is only benefits. It's not going to cut into the lifetime of your card either. It's not going to make the fans work harder because, as we can see, the temperatures are under control. It is definitely worth it. There's also the argument that not now, but let's say in 3 years or 4 years or whenever your card is going to be at the end of its life and the games are a lot more demanding then this overclocking might actually be the difference between you being happy enough with your card for another 3 to 4 months or not. It might be the difference between you playing 4 years in the future. A AAA game at 60 FPS or not, or being playing it at 50. It might be the difference between that, and it might be the difference between you being happy with the product or not for a certain amount of time, which also means that you won't have to upgrade that soon, which means that you can save your money and have the money you paid for it serve you for a longer period of time, leading to that's basically better budgeting, and you can spend that money in something else, either PC parts or anything else, really. So, do I advise you to overclock your parts? I definitely do. I don't advise you to go crazy, and not that you can go crazy with this because power limit, but I don't advise you to really push it to the absolute extreme because then the benefits. Well, if you're on the very high end of overclocking, the benefits don't really outweigh the risks and the wear on your product. If you're at the average overclock, definitely, I would definitely go for it. Like I said, it's free performance. You already paid for the product and you're getting more out of it. So why would you not? Maybe you're scared because you never overclocked something before. But do some research. I mean, if you're watching this on my channel, you are the kind of person that likes to research and read and hear about stuff. So do some research for overclocking. I definitely endorse it. And yeah, so this is the difference you can expect between a 1660 and a Ti, non-overclocked and overclocked. It's a 5 to 10% difference on average. Some games more, some games less, but that's what you can expect to squeeze out of your card. And yeah, this has been Epic PC Guy trying to stop the video from dragging on even longer. Have fun with your overclocks. Hope you enjoy the extra frame rates. Like, subscribe, all that sort of stuff if you want to help the channel grow a bit more. Share it with your friends, all that sort of thing. And I'll see you next video.